Thank you. No time for after lunch dip. I'm sorry. I have a lot of code, I have a lot of noise, so let's get into it. I want to start the story with a great year in history, 1972. On March 4, I was born, so the year was great. And a month later, a Japanese company, Roland, was founded, and they are making all kinds of stuff for artists, for musicians, and for DJs. And one of the things they produced was this monster of 4.5 kilos, the TR-909 rhythm composer, or drum computer, in 1983. And back in the day, they made about 10,000 copies of it. It would cost about 1,000 euros, which would be now more or less 3,000 euros. And it was a complete disaster. They didn't sell all 10,000. They sell way less of that. And those things ended up in secondhand stores or pawn shops, and nobody really cared about it, essentially. Until a few years later, at around 1978, 1988, for instance, this guy picked it up. I'm sure you don't know him, but this is Tyree Cooper. He is a DJ and producer from Chicago. And back in the day, something like house music was coming up, electronic dance music. And he bought that thing, the TR-909, for a little amount of money, and he made a lot of records with it. But not only in the house scene of Chicago it was used, it was also used by the Queen of Pop, Madonna herself, in Vogue, for instance. And maybe you recognize these guys, they used it as well. So it became more and more popular. To keep you awake after lunch, maybe you can help me and identify this one. Anyone? Yes, Pump Up the Jam by Eric E. and Yakit K. from Technotronic. Good, good. You know your classics. Another one to get the party started. This one. Yes, Ray and Anita from Amsterdam, Two Unlimited. Great sounds, music I grew up with, and great fun. And who am I? I'm Rowdy. I used to be a club DJ in the late 80s and early 90s. I started at about 16 years old or something like that. And this was the music I loved. Now, I built my first website in 1996. As I said, I was born in 72, so I'm pretty old already, but I still love it. Nowadays, I'm a front-end focused senior DevOps engineer with special attention for accessibility, and I will try to add another word to it next week at a large Dutch insurance company. And I'm happy to say that yesterday I have become a Google Developer Expert in web technologies because I do stuff like this. I'm really happy about that. And I will continue doing this. All right, let's make some noise. Let's talk about the Web Audio API. It's not commonly known, but it's in your browser. It's in all major browsers. And it's a way to be able to manipulate music, create sounds, create a lot of noise as well. Let's go by it step by step. First of all, we need to have something that's called an audio context. That's like the wrapper around everything. And the way you create it is like just get a new audio context. Next up, we need an oscillator node. An oscillator node makes the sounds, actually. We create that. We hook it up to the audio context, and we need something that's called a frequency. Well, the frequency is when it's low, then it's a low tone. If it's high, it's a high tone. It's measured in hertz, so usually you can hear between, I think, 500 hertz until 20,000 hertz. I can hear approximately until 15 kilohertz, probably, but if you're younger, you can hear high notes. And this is how we give a 440 hertz, that's an A note if you're a musician. But then we also need a waveform that, well, gives the sound actually to that tone. There are four common ones, like the sine, watch your ears.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty smooth. You hit a clicks, but that's just going one hertz or a few hertz up. The triangle is similar. The square is really weird. It reminds me of the 8-bit computer games I used to play when I was way younger. And we have the sawtooth that is steadily going, then dropping. I hope they blow. So for instance, if I do this, a 440 with sine, I can then connect it to the audio context destination, and the destination is, in this case, these speakers around here. I will start it, and I will make sure that I stop it at 2 seconds after I'm starting it. I'm using here the current time of the audio context because it's way more accurate than if you would do set timeout, for instance. There you have that A note. Well, that's all fun and games, but I want to create beats. And you can do it by using these waveforms and stuff like that. But it's really complicated. You get a lot of code doing this. So a better way to do it is just use MP3 files, or in this case, I'm using WAV files. WAV files have been around since 1991. They're uncompressed, very high quality, and excellent to use in this case. For instance, if I want to make a sort of a drum computer with four pads, I can use those waveforms. So let's dive in a little bit. What I did is I created four buttons. I gave them data attributes that I will explain why I did that. Because I can now iterate over those buttons, saying, well, give me the pads. And for each pad, I'm adding an event listener on the click. And when you click it, then it will load the file that's in the data attribute called data wave. In this case, for instance, the first one is the 909 kick, or the last one is the open head, for instance. And then I can play that sample. We're defining here two methods, load file and play wave. So let's dive into a little bit how you would do that. The load file will just do a fetch to, in this case, my local server, like you would do on an API. So that response, we need to create an array buffer for it so we can use it later on. Because we need to create something that's called an audio buffer. The audio context has the decode audio data method for that, and we returned it so we can use it in the play wave. So it's receiving an audio buffer, and then we create an audio buffer source node. With that audio buffer, we connect it to our destination, so our speakers, and then we can start it. We don't have to stop it because it's a sample for maybe half a second, or if it's longer, it's fine as well, but it will stop it by itself. But that's a lot of code to write just to play some WAV files. There's a nice library out there that's called Tone.js. And Tone.js is essentially a wrapper about around the web audio API. And it gives you way easier methods to deal with stuff like this. So, for instance, the kick, I can create a new tone player and load that WAV file and send it to the destination. And I only have to do kick.start. So that's already way less code to do stuff like this. So it makes your life pretty easy. So instead of doing this and this, I can now say, for instance, I drop the data.wave and I'm only using the data.node. The data.node will come into effect a little bit later. I'm defining the kick, clap, close hats, and the open hi-hats. And what I did here is I iterate around over those buttons again, over those pads. And in this case, I'm using a switch saying, well, which data node are you using? If it's 40, start the kick, and 42, start the closed hi-hats, for instance. There are other ways to do this, but for this purpose, I chose the switch statement. But I want to be able to control it with this thing. This is a MIDI device. yeah, that's my face, but here you go. I really got it here. So it has pads on it and it dials we can use. For that, to be able to use it, we can use the Web MIDI API. That's also in every major browser except Safari. It is what it is. But it enables you to connect these devices to your computer and be able to interact with it, either receiving data from it or sending data to it. The way to do it is pretty straightforward. We have to check whether it's supported or not because Safari. So if we are able to request MIDI access, we end up in the success method. And the success method gives us MIDI access. That MIDI access, really important part of that is that we get the inputs. So if I hit something on that MIDI device, it's going to be available to me. So what I want to do is listen for every input, because some MIDI devices have more inputs than one. And I add an event listener to the MIDI message. And if I get a MIDI message, I will put it through to the handle input method I created. But MIDI message, let me elaborate a little bit on that, contains of three integers in an array. The first one is the command. Usually it's on or off. It varies from different MIDI devices, so you always have to check what number it's supposed to be for that device. The second one is the node, and node is not essentially like it's an A or a B or a D flat. It's more or less which button do you hit. And the third one is the velocity. How hard is that pad or key or the dial, how far is it turned? That's the velocity. It goes from 0 to 127. So if I want to do this, I have my buttons, and now I have my handle input. And as I said, it's an array. I'm interested in the node, so what button is hit, and I'm interested in the velocity. I could listen to whether it's on or off, but I like to listen to the velocity. If it's zero, apparently you released it. If it's higher than zero, then you pressed it. So if the velocity is higher than zero, I just say, get me the data, through the data attribute, give me the button and just click it. So I'm able now to do it with my laptop. I can click with the mouse on it, and I have a MIDI device that does the same. Well, let's do a very short demo of that. Let me plug it in. So if I now hit my keys here, don't do that. You hear, but I can also now connect the MIDI device, and you see it's an Akai MIDI device, and if I hit the buttons now, I can make a lot of noise and irritate you all day, but I'm not gonna do that, let's switch back. But you get the idea, right? I get inputs that I can use further on. All right, but I wanna do this. I love this thing. I wanna make a drum computer, or as you could call it as well, a sequencer. And that's used a lot in modern EDM as well. Like you have patterns that repeat time after time. So let's see if we can create that. I can't afford the TR-909. It's nowadays, if you want to buy it, it's around 8,000 euros. And I don't see myself carrying it around in my hand luggage on the plane as well. So I bought a cheaper one, also from Akai. This is a Fire. It looks a little bit like the TR-909, but I have four rows now. On the original one, you had to switch every time. But I also recreated it in the browser. So later on, if I share the link, you can play around with this as well. You don't need a MIDI device. You can do it in the web interface as well. And if you look at this line, it has 16 pads, and one on the front, and the one on the front is to mute the whole line. So you can play music, you can play the beats and say, well, I don't want to have the kick or the hi-hat at this point, so you can turn it off. You can also see sliders on top, pan low, pan high. I can, for instance, have the kick and the clap go to the your right, and I can set the high ones to the other side. I also have a way to manipulate with a pitch. I have some voice samples as well. Through tone.js, I can manipulate that pitch, and I can set the BPM as well. But how did I do that? Well, actually, it's just checkboxes. Checkboxes everywhere. For instance, this is the kick, but I have multiplied this by four because I have four lines. If we want to be able to use the MIDI device, I now had to create the handle input a little bit different, saying, well, if the velocity is over zero, I only look at the notes 54 until 117, because those are the ones in the four lines. And if you hit one, we'll just check the box of that input. To be able to play this, I used tone.js again. And to do that, we can say tone transport dot schedule repeat, and it will be very accurate in repeating stuff. In this, I add 16 because I have 16 buttons, so it will repeat time after time. And that repeat function, I simplified it here a little bit, but you can look at it the code later on. It's more or less like it will go through all the 16 ones and see if it's checked or not. If it's checked, and it's not muted, the whole line is not muted, then we just start the WAV file. That's essentially what we're doing. And I do some stuff with CSS as well to light them up, but you get the idea. So I'm going to use this one. Let me plug it in. It's always fun going to customs with this. They always pick my bag. I don't know why. Like, are you having some weird stuff with you? Nope. But I'm also going to use this one for some extra samples, but also I found out that the dials on the fire one, on the big one, only give me 0 or 127, so it's on or off. And the other ones on the small one are better. It is what it is. Are you ready for noise? Ooh, love it. Let me switch to another demo. So here we are. Yeah. So what I can do now is either use my mouse or trackpad here to click some things, but I'm not going to do that because I want to be able to see it here as well. If I press buttons here, I can't show you, but what happens is, oh, I'm saying that, but what I need to do is I have to connect MIDI, otherwise it won't work. Let me refresh. So I press this one, that one, so the first ones in every four steps. And maybe have some claps as well. I have a note here to see what I have to do because my memory is not that great anymore, but that's okay. We'll get there. And this one as well. And this one is easy. So essentially, I've programmed stuff now. I'm able to record stuff, so I'm hitting the button you can see below that's red now. And let's start it a bit. And if I stop it and I stop the recording, you see I have a recording here that I can play now. So I can save all my very lousy mixes. I'm going to record it again, and let's see if I can manipulate some stuff as well. So we'll be right back. think we only have mono because I didn't hear the high ones anymore. Yes, that's annoying people. You can do anything you want with it. I had four samples here I'm using, but you can use many more as well. Let's go back to another thing I want to show you, is that we also have the web Bluetooth API in the browser. And support, a little bit less, but still I'm using Chrome here, so that's okay. With web Bluetooth API, you can connect Bluetooth devices, Bluetooth low energy devices, to the browser and interact with it. How does that work? Well, pretty straightforward, essentially. You can say, well, I would like to request access to this device, and a smart way is to use a name prefix for that, because I've seen a friend of mine doing this on stage at a pretty big conference, and he found 200 mobile devices, and somehow Chrome died. I don't know why, but... So I'm looking for a particular Bluetooth device and a particular service, and that service is a UUID. All right. With that device, I now get a server, a GET server. That's more or less an array of objects. From that server, I would like to have that service that I'm requiring, the object. From that object, I want to have a characteristic, a specific one, and that's more or less a property. And when I have this property, in this case, what I'm going to do, I'm going to listen for notifications. So every time that Bluetooth device sends a notification, does something, I want to interact with it. I'm going to use this one. This is a Polar heart rate monitor. You saw that I could manipulate the BPMs, the beats per minute, but I want to make it a little bit more interesting with HBPM, heartbeats per minute, and see how that goes. As I said, I'm listening to events. In this case, it's the characteristic value changed. And what it gives me is a value of my heart rate. It could be 80, 100, I don't know what it is at this point, but we'll see. And I just can say, well, to tone again, set the BPM to this value. Are you ready? Yay, ooh, one person is happy. All right, let's refresh that. Let's initialize. Also, I have some JSON files that I can preload stuff with. So this is a song by Faithless that's more or less like this. You can dance to it, right? Well, let's see how it is on my heart rate. So I'm going to turn it on. Yeah, put it on my arm. And let's see, let's click HBPM. And the browser always asks for permission to pair with the device. So every time I put it on, I have to make sure that I'm saying, well, yeah, I want to pair with this one. So this is native in the browser. Now let's pair with it and see what my heart rate is. 80. Oh, that's okay. But if we're playing this, it's not it, right? I can do, that doesn't really help. Is everybody sitting in these chairs? All right, let's see. Stamina is pretty okay-ish, apparently. I've had it going up to 140, but this is pretty okay. Let's stop this. what we do for talks. I'm not going to pronounce this because I'm going to butcher it. I'm going to say thank you very much. Look at this young little pretty boy from 16 years old. And if you want to have the slides and the demo code, either go to the URL or scan the QR code. And thank you very much, and have a great time this afternoon.